Micah. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I set before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, and what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with tens of thousands of rivers of oil? Shall I bring my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body, for the sin of my soul? He told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My soul, the Lord. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who shall prepare your way before you." I tell you, among those born of women, no one is greater than John. Yet the least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. And all the people who heard this, including the tax collectors, acknowledged the justice of God, because they had been baptized with John's baptism. But by refusing to be baptized by him, the Pharisees and the lawyers rejected God's purpose for themselves. To what then will I compare the people of this generation? And what are they like? They are like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another, "We played the flute for you and you did not dance. We wailed and you did not weep." For John the Baptist had come eating no bread and drinking no wine. And you say he has a demon. The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, "Look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners." Nevertheless, wisdom is vindicated by all her children. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's home, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisees who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she is a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." "A certain creditor had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. Now which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one for whom he canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning towards the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little." Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sin?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." The word of the Lord.
Amen.
now in the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Good evening.
Good evening.
It is really a joy and a real privilege to have been able to share just a little bit in the bicentennial celebration of this wonderful and incredible diocese of the Episcopal Church. And I really bring you the greetings and the salutations and felicitations and all sorts of invitations from your brothers and sisters who are the Episcopal Church scattered about the world. We celebrate with you. Reverend Laura said at the early service, when one part of the body rejoices, we all rejoice. Actually, she didn't say it first. St. Paul said it a long time ago. But it is a joy. And as I said earlier, your bishop is a dear friend and colleague and a brother in Christ. And as I said, with the exception of his choice in baseball team, Bishop of Massachusetts is here from Boston. He came all the way. And I root for anybody who beats the Yankees. But that's only in baseball, because in basketball, I remember we were somewhere, and the tournaments were, it was probably around March Madness time, and a group of bishops had gathered, and we were watching the games, and your brother, and my brother, your bishop, roots on the right side then. And there were several bishops of African descent gathered at this particular basketball outing, and so we had a brief caucus, and we agreed that in light of the wisdom with which your bishop rooted, that we would make him an honorary bishop of African descent. So. Joy to be with my brother, your bishop, and with you, the people of God. Happy birthday. Allow me, if you will, then, to just share some reflections that I've been living with. And it's coming from some experiences, and maybe even our cultural context. Let me offer as a text the words that come from the first chapter of the Acts of the Apostles. Now, the setting of this is the crucifixion has happened. Jesus has been killed, no question about it. Executed by the powers of the empire. But then he rose from the dead. I mean, he was alive. I mean, he was really alive. I mean, this is not a metaphorical fiction now. I mean, the brother was alive. I wouldn't be doing this gig if I didn't believe he was alive. I'm telling you. And the first disciples, apostles, all those folk, they eventually experienced him in a variety of ways. And they didn't even know, they didn't quite know how to describe it, because resurrections of folk don't happen every day. And so the language didn't made for that, and so they didn't know, and so the gospel accounts are like all chaotic, because they're dealing with the inbreaking of the kingdom of God in the life of a person. They didn't know what to say. But he had been teaching with them for a little while, and he knew that the time was going to come when he was going to have to withdraw that physical presence with them, ascend, we call that the ascension, to ascend back to the Father. And he was getting them ready, and they had one last conversation. And Acts records it this way. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore to us the kingdom of Israel? Jesus replied, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But know this, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. It is not for you to know the times or the seasons that my Father has fixed by his own authority, but this much you need to know. You will be my witnesses, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the end of the world. Now behind their question was looming a natural human query. They had seen him executed. They experienced him alive, risen from the dead. They knew some kind of miracle had happened, and so they knew that in some way God had broken into human history again in some miraculous and wondrous way. And so they naturally assumed that this must be the moment. This must be the messianic age breaking in. This must be the time when God's going to come in God's fullness and God's reign is going to be everywhere. This is going to be the time when we're going to make poverty history. This is going to be the time when justice is going to roll down like a mighty stream and righteousness like an ever-flowing brook. This is the time when no child's going to go to bed hungry ever again. Oh, this is the time when we'll beat our swords into plowshares and our spears into pruning hooks. Oh, this must be the time of the kingdom. Lord, is this the time when you restore the kingdom to Israel? And Jesus answers, it is not for you to know. But see, that's a very polite biblical way of saying, it ain't none of y'all's business. see, that those queries are for God and for God alone. There's just some things that God knows that we don't. Like my grandma used to sing that song, we'll understand it better by and by when the morning comes. No, there's just some things that's for God to know and not for us to know. He said, that's not your job. This is your job. You will be my witnesses. My witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria. You will be my witnesses in first century Palestine and 21st century Massachusetts. My witnesses. That's good biblical stuff. I mean, it's good biblical stuff. This thing about being witnesses is all over the Bible. It's in the Hebrew scriptures. Isaiah, right near the servant songs in Isaiah 43, where the Lord says to the Jewish people, you shall be a light to the nations. You shall be my witnesses. It's right there in the Hebrew scriptures. It's in the Christian New Testament. In Luke's gospel, at the end of the gospel, Jesus kind of gives a kind of Luke's version of a commissioning, and Jesus says to the disciples, this has all been written, that the Messiah must suffer and then rise from the dead, and on the third day be raised from the dead, in order that repentance and forgiveness of sin might be proclaimed to all the nations. And then he says, and you are witnesses of these things. And then in our reading, you shall be my witnesses. My witness is Jesus talking. You, contemporary Christians, you, mainline churches, worrying about your numbers, right? You will be my witnesses. You in America. In 21st century America, in this contemporary mission moment, you shall be my witnesses. Now Reverend Laura is the head of the Massachusetts Council of Churches, which is one of the ways that we participate with our ecumenical brothers and sisters in the work of the kingdom. I just need to let you in on secrets, brother. If you want to give an Episcopalian a heart attack, ask them if they've been saved. and if you really want to take them out or run them away, tell them you got to go out and witness. And I say all that with great love and affection. because I mean, I'm born and bred Episcopalian. My swaddling clothes were an Episcopal flag. This is the church I was born and raised in, baptized on the eighth day according to the 1928 Book of Common Prayer. Now that's showing up baptism. And I say that knowing, I don't know nuclear physics or astrophysics. I don't know that, but I know church, and I know my church. And that word witness just does not roll naturally off the tongue. of not just Episcopalian, but of the Anglican tongue. It just doesn't naturally roll off. And yet the truth is, it's all over the Bible. But I also know Episcopalians about this Bible. Wherever there are two or three, there's always a lawyer. And there's a whole lot of lawyers in this church. And lawyers by profession and training, and Episcopalians by inclination and naturalness. If there is a loophole in the law, we will find it. And I think the default loophole for an Episcopalian is, yes, preacher, it may be in the Bible that we're supposed to be witnesses of Jesus Christ. We know all that, preacher, and that's really nice, and thank you for sharing this morning. But the truth of the matter is, it may be in the Bible, but if it's in the prayer, if it's not in the prayer book, we don't have to do it. So Doug, I went to the prayer book just to see, and did a little research just in case. And lo and behold, on page 517, the service of the ordination and consecration of a bishop. All right, Alan, I got this. It's page 517. I read these words, and I quote, "A bishop in God's holy church is called to be one with the apostles in proclaiming Christ's resurrection and interpreting the gospel and to testify." That's in the prayer book. To testify to Christ's sovereignty as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Lord have mercy. Just give me a few more years with that House of Bishops, and they're going to be testifying all over the place. Just testify. No, we're called to witness. But don't think it's just bishops now, because I went to the service of holy baptism and went to page 302. You can look this up and check me out later. And on 302, there are prayers that we pray over the candidates at holy baptism, and we repeat them again at confirmation, because we know sometimes people forgot what they promised to do, and so we got to send a bishop around to remind them. And so we do it at least twice at baptism and then again at confirmation, and we pray these words, "Now, Father, send them out as witnesses to your love." I'm closing this loophole, brothers and sisters. We just closing it. Then, if that's not enough, in the catechism, the teaching office of the church, page 855, where the question is, what is the ministry of laypersons in the church? The answer in the catechism, check this out, how many lay people are sitting here right now? Let me see some hands. Clergy, y'all still lay people. Raise it. Let me see some hands. Come on. We all lay. Yeah. All right. Anybody baptized is a lay person. Ordained, lay, that's us, right? Well, what is the ministry of everybody who just raised their hand? This is what the prayer book says, page 855. The ministry of lay persons is to represent Christ and his church and to bear witness to him wherever they may be. Don't you feel that loophole just kind of closing? And then last but not least, at the conclusion of the Holy Eucharist, we have two post-communion prayers. And one of those post-communion prayers, the one found on page 366, reads thusly, and I quote, "And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful." When I hear that word witness, let me tell you what goes through me. I imagine I'm back home in North Carolina, and it's spring, and it's Saturday morning, and I get up, and
coffee on and take the bacon out of the refrigerator. My wife eats that like vegetarian bacon. I don't know what that is, but I get my bacon out and I put my bacon, I don't want to mistake it. But anyway, I put my bacon on and get the bacon. You know that smell of bacon when it's really cooking? It really is an incredible aroma. And then the coffee starts to perk and go through all that stuff and you begin to smell that smell of coffee and bacon and put a little toast on. And multigrain is fine, but put a little toast on and just those smells just kind of come over. Then you just take kind of a piece of toast and some bacon and take the coffee and go in the living room and sit and the front door is open and the curtain is open and just kind of sit and the sun is out and off in the distance you can kind of hear children. You know, you can hear them playing because it's early Saturday morning and you can hear the dog, you know, next door barking, always gets in our garbage, but I can hear him barking and I'll keep my eye out in case he jumps into the yard. I'll chase him away. But anyway, nonetheless, but it's kind of it's a bucolic, I think Norman Rockwell's from somewhere around here. This would be a Norman Rockwell moment. Let me tell you, it's just sheer beauty with the smells of coffee and bacon and somebody's cutting their lawn and you can actually smell the grass, fresh cut, grass, and I just happened to look out the window as I put the newspaper down, and I can see off in the distance, it looks like two people. It's like they're coming toward our house. And I'm a little Episcopalian, and so I put the coffee down, and I go over and pull the curtain shut. Shudder that goes through me, but the truth of the matter is, we really did, in spite of my anxieties, in spite of all of that, we really need some witnesses. Jesus was right then, and he's right now. We need some witnesses. Stay with me, I'm coming to it. We need some witnesses in our time and in our particular culture and country to a way of being Christian that actually looks something like Jesus. Oh, let me tell you something. So forgive me if I get it wrong, because the truth is, Christianity has been hijacked into looking like a religion that doesn't look anything like Jesus. It's been hijacked. And we need a counter-narrative of a Christianity that's not made up, that's not something we create, that's actually a reflection of the Jesus we heard about in that gospel when religious folk wanted to mistreat her and put her down. The Jesus who said, that's my child, that's my sister. And then the Jesus who went on and taught him and said, you know something? Yeah, she done sinned a whole lot. Y'all done sinned a whole lot too. This is all going on behind the scenes. You have to read between. This is Michael's midrash of the text. But that's what's really going on. He said, yeah, she done sinned a whole lot. Y'all done sinned a whole lot too. He said, but she loves a lot. And because she loves a lot, she's forgiven a lot. Because love covers a multitude of sins. Love can pick you up where nothing else can. Love can heal you. Love can free you. Love can free the world. We need some Christians, a witness to a Christianity that looks like that Jesus. Maybe 12 years ago now, I was filling out members of staff and I was Bishop of North Carolina, finally said, you gotta get on social media. This is maybe 15 years ago now, I've lost track. And so I hemmed and hawed and finally gave in and filled out the form on Facebook, you know, your name and birth date and all that kind of stuff. And I got to religion or religious affiliation and I almost instinctively answered, just wrote in Christian. And I hesitated. I didn't hesitate because I'm not a Christian. Don't misunderstand. Leave, don't start that rumor. That's not. But I hesitated because that word Christian, I was really aware of it in that moment because it was going to go public. That word Christian has been held hostage to ways of thinking that I don't share. And I'm not, you'll never know whether Michael Curry is a Republican or Democrat. I'm not going to tell you. You can guess all you want. You're never going to find out from me. But the truth, and that doesn't matter, because that word Christian has been held hostage to well, just ask millennials. When Pew Research interviews them and ask them to do Sigmund Freud's free association, and ask them what is the first thing that comes to your mind when you hear the word Christian, you know what they answer? Narrow-minded, homophobic, and bigoted. My brothers and sisters, Christianity has been hijacked, and we gotta take it back. But to the Jesus of the Sermon on the Mount, the Jesus who said, blessed are the poor in spirit, the Jesus who said, blessed are you when you are merciful and compassionate, the Jesus who said, blessed are you when you just hunger and work and labor for God's righteous justice to be revealed in the world, the Jesus who said, blessed are peacemakers, the Jesus who said, love your enemies, the Jesus who said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, the Jesus who said, you shall love the Lord your God, your neighbor. This is the whole law. That's Jesus. And we are his movement. We are his followers, and our task in 21st century America is to witness to a Christianity that looks like Jesus, and to call those who make policy and law and who claim to be Christian to understand real Christian values. Well, I probably got myself in enough trouble, so I guess I better sit down. Back in 1978, I was brand new ordained deacon. Just gotten out of seminary, and I knew everything. In fact, I should have been presiding bishop then, because I knew everything. Anyway, just gotten out of seminary, and was in my first church in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, and a little small, wonderful congregation, St. Stephen's Church in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. And we were a small congregation of about 100 folk. And we had kind of two wings in the building. This wing here was where the church was, and then there were a couple of offices. And then there was a second wing, which was kind of a parish hall, but also was a daycare center at the time, run by the Northwest Child Development Center, which was part of the agricultural department in those days. Anyway, so we had the daycare and the church and the church offices. I was sitting in my office, and this was the first day I had actually, I mean, I was so happy. I had an office. I couldn't believe it. I actually had my own office. And I was sitting in the office. I had brand new clerical collars, and they were clean, and my shirts were still the actual color that they were originally. I mean, you know, I was just kind of sitting there in my office, and this is the day of typewriters. I had an IBM Selectric typewriter. I was hot. The kind of had a little ball that you could extend. Remember those? Yeah, that kind. Oh, I was so excited I didn't know what to do. So that when you type the stencil, y'all remember stencils? Yeah. Anyway, so I was just excited, and it was my first day in the church or in the church office, and so I hadn't had a chance to go down and meet the teachers and the children yet. And so one of the children came down the hall, and the bathrooms were right across from my office. And so a little boy came down the hall, and he kind of, you know how children just kind of stand there and stare at you. And, you know, he kind of stood there and stared at me, and I looked and said, hello, honey, how are you? He said, fine. So, what's your name? And then he probably told me his name. And I said, well, I'm Father Curry. And he didn't react. But I wanted him to know I had a title then. But anyway, so he didn't kind of respond. And then he said, are you God? Well, I was flattered, but I didn't want the kid confused, so I gave him an answer, which actually I thought was a pretty good answer. I said, well, I'm not God, but I work for him. Which I thought wasn't too bad. I mean, you know, I had taken GOE recently, so I was still intellectually awake. Now I'm asleep most of the time, but then I was still awake. Anyway, so he went on about his business. I assumed that I had given a good answer. A little while later, a little girl came down to go to the bathroom, and she came and asked the same question. And I started to wonder, I kind of said, okay, kids make an association, house of God, you're in the house, you must be God. You know, it makes some sense. So I didn't think too much about it until all the children came out a little while later, and they were going out to the playground to play. And as they were coming out, they came by and they waved at me, hello God, have a good day, God. And I said, that little evangelist had gone back and told them I was God and got them all confused. And then I kind of sat back and thought, well, don't worry, I ain't got no issues, don't worry. Well, maybe they ought to kind of mistake me for God. I don't mean that I'm God, but maybe Michael Curry ought to be an icon, a stained glass window, that the light of God so shines through my life that when folks see me, they actually see something of him. Maybe folk ought to see something about those who have been baptized into the name of Jesus and so see Jesus so vivid in their lives, seeing the compassion of Jesus in their lives, the love of Jesus in their lives, the goodness of Jesus, the kindness, the forgiveness, the strength of Jesus, the justice of Jesus so vivid. Maybe, please God, someday folk will look at the average Episcopalian and say, you sure enough look like Jesus. And maybe, the day will come when people hear the word Christian and think of love again. Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? No, you're still in 21st century America. And it's not your business to know the times or the seasons, but this is your business. There you go. This is your business. You will be my witnesses. Today, tomorrow, and to the end of the age. God love you. God bless you, and may God hold us all, and I mean all, in those almighty hands of love.
I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and stood at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. Next, he shall come to judge
It's hard to follow that up with words. But welcome. I'm Tom Callard. I'm the Dean at Christ Church Cathedral, and welcome to your cathedral. I am awfully glad that everyone is joining with us tonight, but I just have a couple of announcements. The first is that we have a reception following the service in the Kendrick Room, which is up the stairs on the right-hand side, and we invite everyone to come and join us in the reception. The offering tonight is going to, in the name of our presiding bishop, is going to the ERD, the Episcopal Relief and Development Fund, in particular for Puerto Rico, for the people of Puerto Rico. We are also going to have a service and prayer and collection toward the end of the month on the 29th for the people of Puerto Rico. It directly affects members of our cathedral community, so it's something that's certainly near and dear to us. I want to thank the choir. Thank you very much for being here. Charles have been an amazing team to work with, so we really appreciate them. We also want to thank the Cathedral Altar Guild and the Flower Guild for their work. And I want to thank Bishop Curry. And it may sound wrong, but I was hoping he would break the pulpit. I don't know if that's a, because what a great story that would be, saying, well, how did your pulpit break? Well, Bishop Curry was here and he broke it. You go to other churches where he's been, and it's the same thing that's happened. But I think he's breaking, hopefully, our sense of this staid New England community and the climate here. So thank you so much, sir. We appreciate that. And we pray for you every single Sunday. I think we all do. So thank you. I have, this is part of our Bicentennial anniversary, so I don't want to lose track of that. And we've invited our rabbi in residence, Mark Shapiro, who just had some minor surgery, to offer a reflection about the Bicentennial. And Rabbi Shapiro can't be here tonight, but I want to share with you what he wrote. In our family room at home, we have a photo that is both new and old. It's new insofar that it arrived in the family room recently. For several years before that, it hung in my uncle's apartment in Chicago. It hung there until he passed away in late August and came home with me to its new setting in Massachusetts. However, the photo is old insofar as it comes from around 1925, and it presents my two paternal grandparents smiling and embracing each other. Now that my grandfather and grandmother are in my family room in this new and old photo, I find myself looking at the photo quite regularly. I wonder what's really going on with this fabulous, when this fabulous photo was taken. Why those smiles on their faces? And I wonder, too, what they might think about me. I wonder what they would say. What would they say if they could peer into their future, 1925 to 2017? Or for the purpose of this afternoon, imagine with me that it isn't 1925, it's 1817. October, 1817. What might those people from Springfield who gathered for Episcopal worship two centuries ago say or think or feel about us? If they could see us today, would they believe their eyes? Or if those who worshiped in this diocese in 1917 could see us? Or those who worshiped in this cathedral 50 years ago in 1967 could see us? What would those who came before us want to know of us, and how would they feel about us? Here is my hunch. If those who came before us, 1817, 1917, or 1967, could see us now, I suspect they would be surprised, perhaps shocked, certainly amazed, because if nothing else, we do look so different. And at the same time, I suspect that if those who came before us were to pause for a moment, I think they would be delighted and proud because the seeds they sowed have taken root. We are here. A congregation is here. People are worshiping God. As different as we must be from the builders and founders, I believe they would take great pride in knowing that our hopes and faith are still theirs. They would recognize the words read this morning in church. They would thrill to them as much as any of us do from Isaiah 25, O Lord, you are our God. We will extol you. We will praise your name, for you have done great things. You have been our refuge. You have been our shelter. You have been our shepherd. As it has been, so it may it be always. Amen. On behalf of Rabbi Shapiro, happy Bicentennial. I want to invite Laura Everett from the Mass Council of Churches to say a word.
Friends, I bring you the blessings and greetings of the Massachusetts Council of Churches. We are a network of individuals, congregations, and denominations convinced that what binds us together in Christ Jesus is stronger than anything that might divide us. Anything that might divide us, and sometimes, church, our denominations divide us. The head of the National Council of Churches once said, denominations make for powerful adjectives and idolatrous nouns. Powerful adjectives and idolatrous nouns. So, Bishop Curry, it is not lost on those of us from other branches that you speak of a Jesus movement, and that you see the other branches of this self-same movement, that we who are together part of one vine, and one witness, and one church. We see how you speak of this, and we are grateful. Because, church, it is impossible to witness to the reconciling love of Christ Jesus if we are not reconciled to one another. And so for this, we work and pray and believe that the church is already one. And so we celebrate with you today. We celebrate with you and we give thanks. Bishop Curry, we give thanks for your leadership in the whole of the body of Christ. Bishop Fisher, we give thanks for your leadership in the whole of the Church of Massachusetts. And Christ Church Cathedral, we give thanks for your witness of faithfulness for 200 years, not just to Episcopalians, but to the whole of the people of Springfield. We are so grateful. The common church in the Commonwealth celebrates you today. Amen.
So at the morning service, Michael Curry gave us this great myth that it's true that Alan Gates and I were there in Salt Lake City, but locked up in the cathedral until he got elected, which is on the first ballot. But then the myth comes in. He says that it was only 5 minutes later that I went over, congratulated him on being the new presiding bishop, and asked him to come to the cathedral right here in 2017. He said it was 5 minutes. Myth. It was 15 minutes. 15 minutes later, I asked him, and he said yes. And he said yes because an incredible preacher. So I've gone around the last 2 years saying to all of our churches, come out and hear Michael Curry. He's the greatest preacher I've ever heard. Come to the cathedral. So are you glad you came? And I knew he'd be incredible because, 10 years ago, 12 years ago, my son, who was a teenager at that time, went to the Episcopal Youth Event in Kentucky. And Michael Curry was the preacher. And he came back home, and he said, Mom, Dad, I heard an amazing sermon from Bishop Curry. So how many times have you heard a teenage boy say the word sermon and amazing in the same sentence? Michael must have been doing something right. And we also thank Michael because he's got an incredible schedule. You know, we were together, Al and I were together with him in Alaska just a couple weeks ago. And then he went from Alaska to Detroit, Detroit to Milwaukee, Milwaukee to England, England to Atlanta, and now to here. Now when he leaves us tomorrow, he'll be going to Maryland, right, Sharon? And so it's 48 hours, but it's a 48 hours that we'll remember for a really long time. So again, we want to thank Michael for his inspiration. And two, in terms of this 200th anniversary, this has been a great celebration, a real highlight. But there have been other highlights too, other highlights in terms of people of the cathedral witnessing to the gospel, going out to those tough streets of Springfield and witnessing to the gospel, going out on Tuesday nights during the winter to bring coats and blankets to those who are sleeping outside. The witness you've had about the opioid crisis just a couple of weeks ago to start a movement that addresses that here in Springfield. But another really, really great day was that day in May 2017 when we installed Tom Callard as your dean. that's a day that's going to remain with us for a long time, too. So we want to thank Tom for this. And I think that's our lesson. Okay? Who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication unto thee. And has promised through thy well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, thou wilt be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, in the world to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
Michael, may we have your blessing.
Amen.